Welcome to our forum. Y'all here tonight there?
Yes.
Good. Tonight, we're going to talk about Violet's plan to quit this hospital, end it, and try to get some further information on what their plans are, what they're going to do, what kind of emergency facilities we'll have. Dr. Herman will be answering a lot of questions. And Dan?
Yep.
Dan, he's the bad guy. He's going to be keeping track of how many minutes you use in asking your questions. We're going to try to keep that time to 3 minutes per question. And he's got a series of signs. Why don't you show him one of your signs?
I do have signs. 3 minutes.
3 minutes, right?
When you see that, time is up.
There you go. So we're going to try to be respectful. We're going to try to be respectful of each other's time. If you take more than 3 minutes, you're taking it away from somebody else. So understand that. And we want to be respectful to the people that showed up today to talk to us. This takes a lot of courage, I believe, to explain a situation like this to a bunch of folks who may not be happy about it. But I hope you'll listen with an open mind and try to learn as much as you can. Anything else I need to mention to anybody? All right, so you're going to also choose questions, is that right? We're going to start with a statement from the doctor. So we'll begin with that.
I got my pen here. Thank you very much, Bill. Thank you very much for coming this afternoon, or this evening. We're very proud to be here. Start right off and say, when we came here in 2011, our commitment was to maintain health care here. And what you're going to hear tonight is how we can sustainably maintain health care here. I have a list of questions that Adam O'Neill was gracious enough to give me. And so I'll start by answering some of those questions. The first question that they have on the list is, how long have you been with Biden Health, and what is your background? Actually, I think the courageous thing is I have to put my reading glasses on. No one likes to do that. I joined Biden Health in June of 2011. As a matter of fact, I sat right over there in this auditorium when we had the conversation about Biden for the Pungo Hospital to join the Biden family. I've been here since 2011, and I've been CEO since July 1st of last year. I came from Minnesota. I spent 30 years at the Mayo Clinic in Minnesota. I went to medical school there. I'm a physician, I'm a surgical ophthalmologist. And I spent a significant amount of time in my last 20 years there, both seeing patients and in administration. I was the chair of the clinical practice at Mayo, so I ran the clinical practice for Mayo Clinic. I was on the board of Mayo Clinic, and I was on the board of the Mayo Clinic Health System. I'm very proud to be here. My wife and I live in Greenville. We have 4 children. The oldest one is 29. She and her husband, who's a captain in the Army who just returned from Korea, just had our second grandchild about a week and a half ago. And then our youngest child just turned 20 on Saturday. So we have 1 out of the house and 3 in college and graduate school. So all that's going on. The biggest question I think that everyone wants to ask is, why is Biden closing the hospital? So let's take a little step back to 2011 when we came here. And the reason we were asked to come here is the hospital was having trouble at that time. They were losing over $1 million a year. They had a significant amount of debt, and the hospital was threatened. So when we came here and we talked with the people in the community, we agreed that there needed to be health care here in this region. We talked about the ability to maintain a hospital here long term, and we recognized at that time that there wasn't the ability to do that. But what we said is, let's try to keep it here as long as we can. Because we were very, very hopeful that the economy would turn around, that perhaps reimbursement would go up. And the third thing that's really driving the decision right now is that facility would stand the test of time and allow us to maintain that facility. None of those 3 things have happened. As you know, the economy has not turned around. It has to turn around for the country. It hasn't turned around for North Carolina. and it hasn't turned around for this region. We also saw that when we opened the walls of the hospital, that there was a significant amount of decay that occurred inside the walls. So we've been spending between $400,000 and $600,000 a year just trying to keep the facility safe and open to provide care here. As reimbursement has been cut, and I want you to know that what's happening here today is not the fault of the people who work at Vidatungo Hospital. They work very, very hard. They take great care of patients. It's not the fault of our elected officials. It's not the fault of anybody in this room. The issue is that the United States spends more money than they think they should on health care, and they're trying to find ways to cut that. And when they do that, they cut our reimbursement. They cut the money that we get paid for the care that we provide. And that's gotten to the point now where here in Belhaven, we lose in excess of $6,500 a day caring for the patients here. It's terrible that healthcare has to come down to dollars. That makes all of us uncomfortable. As a physician, it makes me uncomfortable. But that's the situation that we're living in right now. Every dollar that we get in Vidant Health is a dollar that's on somebody's bill. And there's no one that thinks that their medical bills are too small. And when Paul and Bill look at their budget for the state of North Carolina, they don't feel that their budget is too large. And when the United States pays for health care, they don't think their budget is too large. There's too many things going on. The reason we're at the sharp end of the point right here is that across the United States, about 40% of health care is paid for by the government. Here in Belhaven, about 75% of health care is paid for by the government. And government reimbursement is designed to be less than the cost of the care that it provides. So we don't have funds that come into Belhaven from other places to help provide that care. We move funds from other places across the system in order to be able to do that. And as other places get challenged, there's less funds to spread around. So let's talk about what we're going to do here. What we're going to do is we're going to transition the care that's provided in that hospital to another facility. We haven't picked a place for that facility right now. We're looking at places where we can build that around within this immediate area. What it's going to be, it's about $4.3 million, and it's going to be 24/7, 365, to provide health care for this region. It's not going to have inpatient beds. It's not going to have the ventilator beds. And it's not going to be classified as an emergency room. Now, I know that emergency care is a concern for everyone here. So let's talk about the services that will be provided at that facility. First of all, many of the primary care services that you are provided right now, all those will be provided there. So we're talking about primary care. We're talking about the cardiology services you get now, the nephrology services you get now, the rehab services that you get now, x-ray facilities, lab. You've heard about emergency services. What we're doing right now is we're working for the EMS in Beaufort County and in Hyde County to build a protocol so it'll allow patients to be picked up by the ambulance and transferred to this facility. The reason we need to do that is because there are state and federal regulations that require us to do that. So we've talked with the EMS physicians in both counties. We're talking with the EMS people at the state to build those protocols. Those protocols are being built on a daily basis right now. When those protocols are built, then we will be able to go to the EMS. EMS will approve them, then we'll be able to go to the state to get those approved. So that means that ambulances can pick up patients within this region, and ambulances can bring them to that facility, and they can be stabilized and cared for at that facility. They cannot be hospitalized there. How long can they stay at that facility? They could stay at that facility for 4 hours, 6 hours, 10 hours, whatever it takes to stabilize them there, or to determine whether they really need to be transferred or whether they can just go home. But it will be time before we know exactly what we are allowed to do in that facility. That facility will have, one of the questions that's asked is, how many employees will that facility have? That facility will have approximately 40 employees, and we have commitments from the current staff here, particularly the medical staff, the physicians, the PAs, and the nurses that staff in us, and be able to provide that care. Another question that's on the list is that asks, well, what's going to happen between the time the hospital closes and the new facility opens? We will move those services I just talked about outside the hospital to the existing outpatient facilities that we have here right now. So the x-ray will be performed in the offices we have here. That care that is needed on an emergent or urgent basis can be performed there until that new facility opens. We anticipate that new facility will be open within the next 18 months. How many visits to the Pungo ED last year? We had 5,412 visits to the Pungo ED last year. More than 75% of them were for primary care or urgent care problems that would require a hospital facility to take care of them. And we are building, I want people to understand this and hear this again. We talked about this with the mayor when we met with him about 2 weeks ago, that we are building the protocols to allow those emergency care patients to be brought there. I know that on the poster that was put out, well, we're not going to be able to give blood at that facility. We will not have a blood bank at that facility. We went back and we looked over the last 5 years how many times blood was actually pulled out of the blood bank and not even administered, not necessarily administered to emergency patients within the hospital, was less than a dozen times. And you don't need blood. When you're in battle, when you're in war, you don't get blood in the battlefield. You get an IV placed in, you get colic solution that supports you to be taken to a place. We'll have the same thing that goes on right here. What were we doing to help the community? Well, we'll be spending $4.3 million to build that new facility. At our board meeting today, that area that where the hospital sits now will be offered back to Pungo Creek LLC. And if it will help them, we'll even remove the hospital from that facility for the cost of about $800,000. So there will be over $5 million of investment in this community just to build that new facility and to rehabilitate the land on which the hospital sits. This ongoing commitment that we have on this 24/7, 365 facility will still require us to take about $3,000 a day from other vital facilities to support health care here. We're very, very happy to have the opportunity to do that. And we're very, very happy to have the conversation with the other hospitals and other places in Biden Health that actually help us make the money to be able to do that. We know that there'll be further cuts in the future. We know that no one wants to pay more for their health care. No one wants to pay more in their taxes. But we are working very, very hard to design new models of care, like the facility that we've talked about just now, to be able to support care in communities like this. I grew up in Minnesota. I grew up in International Falls, Minnesota. And if you've heard of it at all, you've probably seen it on a Sears Die Hard commercial where they put a car out in the middle of the lake on frozen ice and then tried to start it to show it where the battery was. That's a town of about 6,500 people. When people talk about this being a rural area, if you're from International Falls, this ain't rural. When I played high school hockey, my nearest away game was 100 miles away. There's a small hospital at International Falls right now that's probably going to close. The nearest next hospital is 100 miles away. So unfortunately, rural communities in America are feeling the sharp edge of the changes that are going to happen, that have to happen, in order to keep America sustainable. None of us are happy about that, and none of us are comfortable with it. But we're here, and we're here for the long term. I look forward to hearing your questions tonight. I will try to answer each and every question. There's a lot of people signed up on the list. I would ask that if someone's already asked your question, that you yield to the next person who may have a new question. If you want to come up and ask it, make a comment, that's fine. But we'd like to hear from as many people as possible. So with that, I'll turn it over to our MC here and let him get us going.